must be lights burning brighter somewhere. Got to be birds flying higher in a sky more blue.
Good morning. Welcome to Right Thinking with Steve Coplon. I'm your host, Steve Coplon, and thank you for tuning in. Let's have a great day.
Good morning, everybody. Glad to be with you. Well, today is episode number 303. Right Thinking with Steve Coplon is very pleased to announce that this week's show is called The Man in the Ring. Tune in and hear Steve share details of his recent cancer diagnosis and how he draws upon his faith and prayers from his family and friends to know that he will do well as he faces difficult times ahead. You will be strengthened in your own faith as you listen to Steve's message. Well, everybody, I'm Steve, and I just read you the title of today's show and what it's going to be about. And I want to talk with you today about not just what I'm going through, but with why I do it, how I face it, and where I get my strength from, things like that. And my hope is that you will be able to get something from my message that will help you go through life and experience the joy that the Lord intended you to have and get through your tough times and keep moving yourself forward. You know, Right Thinking with Steve Coplon, this show, it's a show that's dedicated to helping anyone who is experiencing hardship and those that want to be there for them. The show's for me. I'm experiencing hardship, but there are so many people that come to me and give me encouragement and offer prayer and want to see how I'm doing. And I think that what we're doing with this show, it's working, it's effective. And so just bear with me for a minute here and hopefully you're going to take a good look at yourself and you'll draw strength from some of the things that I show you that I draw strength from. Well, that's good. Just before I started recording today, I got a call from a cousin of mine. Her name's Libby, and she's a few years older than me. So she's known me my whole life. Libby has known me for my full 71 and a half years. And I love Libby. She's a wonderful cousin. She's very caring. And she just got off the phone talking to my sister Arlene, who had shared some news of what I'm going through with my medical situation. So I want to start off for a moment here, just giving you an update of my medical situation. You know, this is my 303rd show, and I've done a lot of connecting with people by sharing what I do go through and how I face it, because a lot of people, they're going through their own hard times, and sometimes they get to where they want to quit. They get down. They don't want to face it. There's depressions involved, and so I share my personal story because I've found many ways in my life to just keep moving forward. And as I get later on in the show, when you understand my relationship with the Lord, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. But I'll share this tidbit with you. So Libby said to me, well, how are you doing? And I said, oh, I'm doing fine, Libby. Well, how are you doing? She goes, well, what I'm going through is nothing compared to what you're going through. So, you know, I don't even want to talk about anything that I'm going through. And I said, oh, no, Libby, please, you know, no, really, you know, how are you doing? So she shared a few things with me. Well, one of the things that I've always gotten strength from in my life is that, it's Jesus Christ, you know, what Jesus Christ did on that cross when he shed his blood for us. You know, he gave so much that sometimes when a person is apt to maybe complain about how hard something is that they're going through, I like to kind of look at the worst that I've ever gone through in my life is no more than just a hangnail for compared to what Jesus has gone through. So let me just give you a real quick synopsis of what I'm going through. If you've listened to all of my 302 shows prior to today's show, you'll know a lot about my medical history, but I'll give you a recap because nobody's listening to all my shows. I know that. I was diagnosed 21 years ago, to be 22 years ago in January, with a blood cancer called multiple myeloma. It's called an incurable blood cancer. But just to set the record straight, my wife, Donna, she said, well, that's what the doctors say, but that's not what he says, as she points up to the heavens, to the Lord. No, we know that nothing's impossible with the Lord. And in the early stages, 21 and a half years ago, when I was diagnosed, it was very hard to accept it. Took me about a year, night sweats, cold sweats, et cetera, waking up like in a nightmare. And it took about a year before I finally woke up from a nightmare and the atmosphere in the room was totally different. I'd gone through the feeling like I was dying, the white light tunnel, the whole story. But ever since that moment, the atmosphere in that my room in my life, I've never come out of that atmosphere. I didn't feel like I was in my room. And what I realized at that time, I knew Jesus, but I didn't know certain things about my relationship, was that I realized that moment 21 years ago, that night, that this is bigger than me. And I told Jesus, Lord Jesus, please take this from me because it's bigger than me. I don't know how to deal with it. Please help me through this burden. And he has. He's given me purpose in life. He's given me strength. Well, so the multiple myeloma, it's a blood cancer, and it's got cancerous cells in my bone marrow, in the blood in my bone marrow. And back then, if your cancerous cells reach a level of what they like over 30%, which means that 30% of your blood cells in the bone marrow blood is cancerous, then it needs to be treated. And so I went for about 4.5 years before I had to go through any treatments. And then I finally got my levels were up, and I had a couple of what they call lesions, a type of a tumor. And so what happens when your levels get high, you're more apt to start having tumors. And if it gets too out of control, if your percentages go up too much, it's harder to treat it. It's going to be harder. So I went 4.5 years or so, and then I had to have treatments. And so the treatments that I took were an oral form of chemo. The first one I was on for a couple months was called thalidomide, and then they switched me over to one called Revlimid that had just passed its clinical trials. And I was on some kind of a steroid that it's hard to say the name of it, but I call it dexamethasone or something. And it was just those two. And I was on them for, 6 months when I started having some really brutal side effects. I always had what my wife and I called chemo eyes, where sometimes I was just so fatigued, my eyes wouldn't really open. You couldn't see my eyes at all. They were like squinted shut, but they were open. And it was hard, but I took care of all my normal activities. I owned a marina at the time. And I remember we were doing boat shows. And then one of my side effects was I had colitis, severe colitis. I was on like a rice diet for 2 weeks or something. It was very hard. And the doctor wanted to take me off at 6 months, Dr. Alberico, because I was having such a hard time with the side effects. But we hadn't gotten the results to bring the blood level cancer down. And so I said, no, don't take me off, because I didn't really want to go into other types of treatment. More serious type of treatment would be a stem cell transplant, which it's an available treatment for me someday, but I don't want to go into that until absolutely necessary. And so we gutted it out, the doctor and I, for about 10 months. And then he finally said, Steve, I got to take you off of this. It's just too hard for you. And but we've gotten some pretty good results. Well, the title that I was going to give today's show was also subtitle maybe, Renewing My Lease. And I want to explain that. When I took those treatments for 10 months and I finished them 16 years ago, I got 16 years until now without having to take any more of those chemo treatments, chemo and steroid treatments. And that's a pretty good long length of time when they first gave me 5.5 years in my initial diagnosis as the average life expectancy. I am one of the very, very fortunate ones that carry this cancer. When I give fundraising talks, I always share, you've got to stay as healthy as possible so that the cure is coming, technology is coming with the cure, and you want to be strong enough and healthy enough to be able to receive the cure when it comes. Well, that's carried me for a long time because I've tried to maintain a good fitness level. Well, with the current situation, I went 16 years. I had a lot of other treatments along the way that were different than just the chemo. I had for 7 straight years, I had bone strengthening treatments every quarter, a drug category called bisphosphonates that women use that for osteoporosis. And after 7 years, they had to take me off of it because I was having some side effects. And the main thing that that drug category side effect is that it can cause a disease or a condition called Bronj, bisphosphonate, the drug category, related osteonecrosis of the jaw, bone death of the jaw. Multiple myeloma is one of its main target areas is the jaw. So I tell you that because of what I'm going through now. So after 16 years, I've been doing great. I plateaued for about the last 6 or 7 years, which means I was very, very stable level. I go quarterly for 21 years to Dr. Alberico to check me out. Sometimes I go more often, but everything's been very stable. Last March, I took a PET scan for my prostate cancer because my PSA was rising after I had my prostate removed six and a half years ago. And I'd taken 37 days of radiation then because they didn't get the cancer after the surgery. It was still there. So I had to take 37 days of radiation. Well, in March this past year, I took a PET scan as a voluntary measure to see if we could isolate if I had any prostate cancer in my body. If it was in a targeted mass area, concentrated area, we could have radiation. We found that it had metastasized prostate cancer in my hip. So last July this year, 5 months ago, I had some stereotactic radiation, very intense radiation. So that brought my radiation total number of days up to 42 days in 2 different treatment sessions. And so we got rid of that. But the reason they took my prostate out 6.5 years ago was because they said, that's nothing compared to your multiple myeloma. You don't want to fight 2 cancers at the same time. Well, guess what? I'm fighting 2 cancers at the same time. So what happened next is that I had my radiation for my prostate cancer in my hip in July. Well, in the beginning of October, second week or so, I went to the dentist. I go to the dentist 4 times a year because my dental hygiene is a critical component in fighting multiple myeloma. Infections is what multiple myeloma opens you up for, because your immune system is where your bone marrow is where your immune system is controls your immune system, basically. And that's where my cancer is. So I have a weakened immune system. And so I go to the dentist 4 times a year so we can just always keep a close eye on my gums and dental hygiene. And my dentist, Dr. Fernandez, through a routine x-ray, he found a tumor in my jaw. And so he said, you're going to have to see an oral surgeon. So I went to MCV Hospital and saw Dr. Abu Bakr, who, when I got off of those bisphosphonates after 8 years ago, after being on them for 7 years, we thought that I'd had Bronj, but it was not real. That's when we took me off of those bisphosphonates. But Dr. Abu Bakr, he's another saint in my life. And so I went to MCV Hospital, and met with Dr. Abubakar, who scheduled me for a biopsy of my jaw. And I had that done about four or five weeks ago. And we didn't know if it was prostate cancer, perhaps in the jaw, or multiple myeloma, or just benign, or really nothing. Well, I went through the jaw surgery, and it came back as multiple myeloma was active in my jaw. The tumor that they took out was cancerous, malignant, multiple myeloma. Not the best news. And so immediately, Dr. Alberico, we knew that if it came back as multiple myeloma, I'd have to go in for a bone marrow biopsy to see the levels of the cancer and to see a PET scan to see if I had any more tumors in my body. And so we got that done pretty quick, just before Thanksgiving. And, you know, Thanksgiving, I always say, is the marker for me, where I thank the Lord for another year that he's blessed me with. And this year I kind of limped into it 2 days before Thanksgiving. I had my bone marrow biopsy, my 10th one. And the day before Thanksgiving, I had the PET scan. And then I had Thanksgiving, and it was just another wonderful day with family where I was just thankful for the Lord blessing me with so much, another year and family and friends. Well, so then the results of the biopsy and the PET scan came back the week after Thanksgiving. The PET scan came back very good. It didn't show any other tumors or lesions, which is great news, but the biopsy, the bone marrow biopsy, came back not so good. Treatments are required when your levels get basically above 30%. 5 years ago, I had a bone marrow biopsy, and my levels were at 15%, but they've jumped up to 50%, which is why Dr. Alberico and I are moving so fast to get me into treatments. And so I'll do well, because once the treatments start, it inhibits the cancer from being able to grow or spread. And so that's kind of like arresting the cancer so that it won't continue. But then I'm going to be taking my treatments. And I want to tell you about that just for a second. They're going to start this coming week. So Dr. Alberico is putting me back on the same two drugs that I was on 16 years ago, but they have a third drug now that's in the middle of it. It's called Velcade. And supposedly these three drugs all work together beautifully, greatly improved from what I did 16 years ago. And so the first thought is, you know, am I gonna have difficult reactions like I did 16 years ago? And I'm not, because I'm different. You know, my whole life is different now. I'm 16 years older, so maybe I'm not quite as physically strong, but I've got such a beautiful relationship with the Lord that I've learned how to just be still and relax and just accept things and just know that I trust the Lord. I want to talk about that for a second. And all those radiations I've had and all those bone marrows and all these PET scans and whatever other procedures I've gone through, you have to lay still sometimes for an hour or so while the radiation is being administered or whatever. But I've learned, I'll call it technique. I've learned how to lay still and put my mind into a beautiful place. Now I'm going to define something here. There's a difference between positive attitude and strong faith and trusting in the Lord. I've got a positive attitude. I'm very disciplined. And one of the techniques I do is I lay there and to get rid of anxiety, you know, I always pray. I always ask the Lord to help me through this. But what I do is I think about wonderful things, like all the people that love me, all the people that I love. I'll look at my grandkids' little faces, and when we're sharing time in the playroom or something, and just reliving moments like that. I take my mind to a place like that, and that helps me. And then I do these prayers and meditations, but I go to these beautiful places. But I want to tell you the most beautiful thing that I ever had happen to me. So 21 years ago, when I first got diagnosed, almost 22, I had to take a iodine CAT scan where they put this iodine or something in my in my in an IV, and they said to me, Steve, you're going to be very, very flushed, but it's only going to last for about 60 seconds. And this was early out. I was only into the diagnosis for about a year. And so I laid there, and about 20 minutes went by. And then I hit the buzzer, and the nurse that was watching through the glass said, yeah. And I said, when are you gonna give me that stuff that's gonna make me feel all flushed? And you told me not to panic. What? We did that 15 minutes ago. You didn't feel it? No, I didn't feel it. And the reason I didn't feel it was because when I laid down that day, a prayer came to me, this the Lord gave me. And it was this: Dear Lord Jesus, 51 years ago, it was 20 years ago now, 51 years ago, you lent me this body. And it's been a wonderful body. And I have to ask your forgiveness for many things that I've probably done with this body I never should have done. But it's been a wonderful body, Lord. But what I want to tell you is that it's your body. You lent it to me. And if you want to heal it, I want to help you. That's the secret right there that I want to pass on. You know, we are just a vessel for the Holy Spirit. It's not our bodies. It's been lent to us, and it's the Lord's temple. And we want to just submit ourselves to the Lord and do our part to help him heal this body that's his, that he has lent us. Well, that's part of what I do. Once I was taking radiation, and it was hard, and I asked the Lord to help me and hold me tight and comfort me. And the Lord appeared in my mind as being like this like a big giant, and because I was like the size of a little baby, and he held me in his arms and just rocked me like a baby and comforted me. And at the end of the hour, they sort of had to shake me and say, hey, it's over. And I was in this deep, deep meditation. But the Lord has just been so good to me. I want to talk though about, I call this show today Renewing My Lease, the subtitle, Renewing My Lease, because the last time that I went through the treatments that I'm getting ready to go through, I got 16 years. So I'm going into the treatment starting this week with an attitude that I'm renewing the lease of this body that the Lord has leased to me. And so I'm ready for that. I just want to thank all of you. Just like I thank all my family and friends. I think it's harder on people that love me than it might even be for myself. And that's where today's title comes from. You've listened to Tony Sadler do three shows with me now. And Tony's my brother. I love him. He's Antonio's dad. And Tony's a professional boxer in his life. But he's gone through brutal, brutal health conditions for the last 25 years or so. And he struggles, but he's strong. And he and I talk a lot, and we pray, and we're there for each other. In fact, when I went through the bone marrow biopsy 2 weeks ago at Norfolk General Hospital, Centaur Norfolk General, I came out of the pre-op room that my wife was sitting with me. And then I was walking down the hall toward the room where the procedure, the biopsy was going to take place. And I just, no anxiety. I can handle these things because the Lord's with me. And I'm walking down the hall, and I said, Dear Lord, Tony was having a cataract surgery at the exact same time frame. And he had to be put to sleep for it because of his health conditions. They couldn't let him stay awake. And he was a little, you know, I'd say he had some anxiety, but we prayed the night before. And, you know, I told him he was going to do fine. And so I'm walking down the hall, and I said, Dear Lord, I just want you to give as much of my spirit as you can to Tony as he goes through his cataract surgery right now. And Tony, I'm with you. The Lord's with you. You're going to do well. And I walked down into my bone marrow biopsy, just knowing that I was giving Tony my spirit because I was going to be fine and that I wanted him to get through his. And he did get through it just beautifully. Everything's going really well for me, but just like when Libby called today, because my sister talked to her about what I'm going through, she asked me how I was doing, and I said, well, Libby, you know, it's harder on other people, because I'm the man in the ring, And Tony and I gave him this conversation just to lift him up a couple of weeks ago. The Man in the Ring, it comes from picture a professional boxer coming down the aisles to go into the ring for his fight. And all of his handlers are walking in front of him and some behind him, his entourage, so to speak. And one of them jumps up on the apron and opens up the ropes, and the boxer climbs up through the rings and he dances all around, getting a little warmed up, goes to his corner, still got his robe on. And then the referee calls him into the center, says, we're going to have a good, clean fight, that kind of thing. And then they go back to their corner and they come out, and then the bell starts and the fight's going to start. But here's the point. I just want all of you to know something. All of you that are going through hardships, you can handle your hardships. You're strong enough to handle your hardships. The Lord is with you when you open up your heart and ask him in, just like I have done. But here's the point. All of the people that are praying for you, and I love the power of prayer. I just love it that so many people are praying for me. I love it. It gives me strength just to know how much I'm loved and all the people that are praying for me. I'm not alone. But all those people that are praying for me and all the people that are supportive and all the people that are patting me on the back, telling me how strong I am and how much they admire me and those kind of wonderful things. When you get up into that ring and you're facing that fight, you're alone. None of those people are in the ring with you. But the thing I like about being in the ring is that I'm the one that's throwing the punches and the kicking and fighting. I've got a chance to fight and move around. All the people that love me, they're just watching. They're doing what I did for Tony. They're sending me their spirit to keep me strong. But it's harder on my wife. It's harder on my children. It's harder on my brothers and sisters and and the people that I work with, all these people that love me, because I'm in there knowing that I'm going to do well. And they're just praying for me. They believe I'm going to do well, but they're not the ones that are the active participant. So every one of you, every one of us that's in life, that's fighting for something, that's having to overcome our struggles, our adversities, you can draw strength from many places, from the prayers that everyone sends to you. But above all else, your strength comes from the Lord. And I'm just going to go hard in a few minutes on some scriptures that I love, that I use. When I'm in all my procedures, I listen to a lot of worship music and just keep myself in a place where I'm just seeing something bigger than where I'm currently at. But here's a really good one. There's a song that I've been listening to for about 7 or 8 years. It's called Blessings by Laura Story. It's Capitol Christian Music Group that has the copyright on it. But it's the most beautiful song. I'm not going to give you the whole song. Google it. Blessings, Laura Story. But she talks about how we pray for blessings, and sometimes we don't understand where the blessings are. She says that, you know, what if your healing comes through tears? What if 1,000 sleepless nights? What does it take to know that you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? But as the whole song goes on, there's a lyric of the song that I want to give you right now that really speaks to what we're talking about. And when darkness seems to win, we know that pain reminds this heart that this is not our home. It's not our home. What that means is that this life that we have is temporary, and that we are going to be moving on to eternity when we know the Lord. And so for me, I absolutely love this life that the Lord has given me. And in a minute, I'm going to read you some quotes from Jim Stovall. Jim Stovall is, to me, the single most inspirational person in my life that I've become friends with. His life story, he's been on the show many times, but he is just totally amazing. And so I Googled quotes from Jim Stovall before I did the show. And I'm going to read you just a lot of quotes from Jim Stovall because I get inspiration from other people that are going through their own hardships. And Jim Stovall, as you might know, he's blind. He started going blind when he got diagnosed at 18 years old with macular degeneration. And he was going to be the number one college recruit. 100 schools were after him, but he had to change his life direction. But he's just the most phenomenal person. So what I'm trying to tell you is, no matter what you're going through, you know, go to the Lord, find people that you can respect and admire for how they face their own adversity. And I hope that I'm on your list. But with that said, the man in the ring, the man in the ring is always reminds me, it's not the exact same circumstances, but the man in the ring talks about, it's the man in the arena by Teddy Roosevelt that I'm trying to say here. Teddy Roosevelt, in a speech that he gave a year after he after his presidential term ended, Teddy Roosevelt was in Paris, and he gave a speech that day. And that speech was called Citizenship and Republic. But there was a little piece of that speech that became his most famous speech that he ever did. And it's about the individual. And that's what I'm talking to you about. The individual, me, the man in the ring, you, Tony. We have to face life on our own, but we're not really alone because we have all the spiritual input from all those that pray for us. We have the Lord with us. So we're not alone. We can draw strength, but we do have to face certain things within. We have to draw that strength from within that's been given to us by our faith in the Lord and the prayers from our friends. I want to read to you the Teddy Roosevelt's The Man in the Arena. If you've never heard it before, study it, go back. It's phenomenal, as you're going to know in just a moment. This is it. It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, who comes short again and again, because there is no effort without error and shortcoming, but who does actually strive to do the deeds, who knows great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither know victory nor defeat. Teddy Roosevelt, the man in the arena. When you get right down to it, each one of us is the man in the arena, the man in the ring. We need to accept it, and then we need to do the very best we can. Now, for me, my process goes into meditating and thinking about what I'm getting ready to go through. And then I can tell you this, it's never as bad as your mind could let you think it could be if you let your mind and your fear take over. If you're prepared to know that you'll do well, you're going to do well. But if you think negative thoughts and you have fear, you probably won't do as well as you could do. But here's one of the things that I want to pass on to you. If you accept that your life is a gift and that you're going to do the very best you can with it, then whatever happens is good. The sad part is that sometimes we might leave this earthly existence, this life we have here, to move on to the higher place. But if that's you that moves on and you know the Lord, then you're going to be fine. It's just that it's sad for you to think that you might be leaving those that love you. And so that, in a nutshell, gives me strength, because I'm the most motivated man that I know, because I know how much I'm loved. And the least I can do for all those that love me is fight a good fight and do the very best I can while I'm here, so that when I'm gone, my memory to those that love me will be a beautiful memory. It'll give people strength to know that Papa wasn't scared, Papa wasn't afraid. And for me to be able to do the best I can for the comforts of the finances that I need to do for my family, my estate that I need to do. So I don't have time to mourn myself and be sad about what I'm going through. I just want to be thankful for every day the Lord gives me to be able to do what he's got me doing right now and to use me. And I firmly believe that as long as I have purpose and the Lord is using me, I'm going to be strong to give the best fight that I can. So I just want each one of you to know you can be strong to give it the best fight you can, to not have fear, and to be able to accept your situation and then move forward. I want to read you a number of these quotes that I got from Jim Stovall. And I went to Jim Stovall because, like I said, he inspires me more than anyone else that I know in my life, because of his life story and what he's done with his life. And so some of these are not specific to like a health situation, but you're going to see where Jim Stovall faces life in a certain way. And there's a couple of them in here that I might stop and make a comment, but let me just start. You need to be aware of what others are doing. Applaud their efforts, acknowledge their successes, and encourage them in their pursuits. When we all help one another, everybody wins. Beautiful. In those times we yearn to have more in our lives, we should dwell on the things we already have. In doing so, we will often find that our lives are already full to overflowing. Count our blessings. Being successful is a choice, and therefore being defeated is a decision. When you got some hard times here, just keep the fight going. Don't quit. It will get better. That's my Right Thinking Foundation slogan. Don't quit. Plan ahead. It will get better. Here's the attitude. Jim Stovall's got it right here. Life at its essence boils down to one day at a time. Today is the day. I want to talk about that one for a minute. If I were to face life right now with fear that this cancer is pretty come back on me hard after 16 years, and that it's going to be really, really hard, and that I hope I do well, but I don't know I'm going to do well, etc. You know what? That's a lot of fear. But for me to say, Lord, you've given me a lot of time. You've given me a wonderful life. And every day you give me is a blessing. And if I just live in today and do things that are going to make the future better, of course, you know, a penny saved is a penny earned, maybe type Benjamin Franklin. But I don't need to be thinking about, well, I wonder how long I'm going to be here. I set my goal at 100. I still plan to reach it. Let me just tell you that. If you are not, this is Jim Stovall. If we are not allowed to deal with small problems, we will be destroyed by slightly larger ones. When we come to understand this, we live our lives not avoiding problems, but welcoming them as challenges that will strengthen us so that we can be victorious in the future. That's the attitude. Take your problems, learn from them, continue to move forward. Faith is all that dreamers need to see into the future. Yeah, faith. That's what this is. In the end, life lived to its fullest is its own ultimate gift. If you haven't ever watched Jim Stovall's The Ultimate Gift series, the three movies, you should, because it is absolutely full of the most wisdom. It's beautiful. Problems may only be avoided by exercising good judgment. Good judgment may only be gained by experiencing life's problems. When we help one another, everybody wins. Remember that a wish held fervently turns into belief, and a belief held diligently becomes reality. In the end, a person is only known by the impact he or she has on others. Education is a lifelong journey whose destination expands as you travel. Some people are born into wonderful families. Others have to find or create them. Being a member of a family is a priceless membership that we pay nothing for but love. I just absolutely love that my mother passed it on to me, that never met a stranger, give people the shirt off your back. Just love everybody. Just love everybody. Love is a treasure for which we can never pay. The only way we keep it is to give it away. The only way you can truly get more out of life for yourself is to give part of yourself away. I have to say this, that in one of my travels with Merle the Cowboy, when I was hitchhiking back in 1974 out in Colorado, and I met Merle the Cowboy, and I asked him, so what is the most important thing in life? And without hesitation, Merle said to me, the gift of yourself. He who loves his work never labors. Well, that's absolutely certain. Money is nothing more than a tool. It can be a force for good, a force for evil, or simply idle. This is one of my favorite ones. I've said this 1,000 times. I'll say mine first, then I'll let you hear Jim's. Mine is, a lot of the stuff that I'm going through would make you want to cry, but I choose laughter. Here's what he says. Laughter is good medicine for the soul. Our world is desperately in need of more medicine. Control what you can. Acknowledge what you cannot. That's the serenity prayer right there. You know, God grant me the... When I learned it, my first and second verse is reversed than everybody else's, but that's how I learned it back in 1976. God grant me the courage to change the things that I can change, the serenity to accept the things that I cannot. Oh, no, I haven't said it lately. Let me see if I got it right. God grant me the courage to change the things that I can change, the serenity to accept. Wait, let me try it one more time. I haven't said it lately. God grant me the courage to change the things that I can change. The wisdom, it's the wisdom to accept those that I cannot. We're going to have to come back to that. It's the first time I've tried to say the serenity prayer in a while. But I can give you the second verse that nobody knows. But God, give me the strength to not give up on what I know is right, even though I think it is hopeless. Never quit. So it's the strength, the courage, and the wisdom. Strength to change the things I can change. The courage to accept the things that I can. Y'all, somebody give it back to me. I know it. I've got it right on my wall here, but I apologize for not getting it straight today. But I'm human. How about that? So you don't begin to live until you've lost everything. I've lost everything 3 or 4 times, a perfect place to start. Jim Stovall's story is an incredible story. Only when we try to understand one another's sufferings can we begin to bring each other joy. Sometimes in life, you either laugh or you cry, and I prefer to laugh. That's another one that Jim has about laughter. This one is so true. Count your blessings when you hear this one. It is a wealthy person indeed who calculates riches, not in gold, but in friends. I want to thank every single one of you out there for all your prayers and all your friendship, all your fellowship. I believe that I'm the most blessed man in the world. I've seen people recover. This is Jim. I've seen people recover physical abilities, yet never get over emotional trauma after a serious accident. I've seen other people overcome the psychological and emotional trauma of a serious illness, even though they may never fully regain their physical capabilities. Which is the greater healing? Which is the better recovery? If I had the option of choosing between a mediocre life with eyesight or the life I have today, even though I am blind, I'd stay blind and keep the life I have. I want to connect with that for a moment. And I want everybody that's listening, that's looking for ways to move yourself forward and to be stronger in some of the things that you face, to overcome your obstacles. You know, life changes. It's never the same. And like for me, this might be hard for some of you to understand or even believe, so to speak, but my cancer battle over the last 22 years and then fighting prostate cancer as a second cancer, I learned so much about priorities and what is important in life. Some people, they never go through too much adversity and they never settle down and really get their priorities straight. But adversity creates character. So if you're going through something hard, move forward, not backwards. Change yourself. Become the person that you truly want to be. You can. A journey may be long or short, but it must start at the very spot one finds himself. Yeah, you got to accept where you're at and then move forward. There are certain days that are forever locked in our memories. They represent special times, places, and people that we capture in the scrapbook of our minds. Just a fleeting thought of these memories can bring us back to that special time and place, as well as the emotion we felt when we were there. Truer words were never spoken. I already told you that when I lay on the radiation table or going through a procedure, I let my mind go to places where I experience great love of people and moments that I've shared. You can go there. That's what memories are for. But let me tell you this. If you're plagued with demons and bad memories that some people can't shake, you don't have to allow it. You don't have to allow it. Hopefully, when I get to the next part of the show in the next couple minutes with the scriptures that I'm going to share, you're going to know that light defeats darkness. The light defeats darkness. So for me, when I have a fearful thought, and I have them, I've had about 7 or 8 of them in the last month, they'll come on me, and it's a little bit of that old anxiety feeling where I get a little kind of like, got to move around, got to get up, maybe drink a sip of water. If I go more than a minute to a minute and a half, a couple years ago, that was bad. Now I'm down to 30 seconds to a minute. When I have a negative thought, I immediately go to the Lord, because those negative thoughts are not of the Lord. Some of you listening might be saying, oh, this guy's going into all this God stuff, spiritual stuff. Let me tell you, it's real. It is absolutely real. If you want to have a personal conversation with me where you can just go anywhere you want to go with me, with, because you might not believe what I'm saying, I would love to be there for you, to just to hear you. I might not be able to change your mind. You might not want to change your mind yet. But I'm telling you that there may be a day comes where you're not strong enough by yourself. You might be that man in the ring that you're prepared. And I wanted to say this about the man in the ring. If you get out there and you're in your mind thinking, oh, look where I am. I'm fighting for this championship fight. Oh, boy, this is good. And then all of a sudden, you get punched and sit down on your bottom. You cannot be thinking in your mind different than experiencing the moment. You have to deal with the moment as it faces you. In the training and the preparation, or like spring training in baseball, or going into a war where the commanders get their troops all ready and then the battle starts. That's why they have boot camp, where it's practice to be ready. You know, everybody always wonders, when they're faced with a very rough, tough decision or situation in life, how will they handle it? I believe that a mark of knowing yourself is having the faith, trusting in yourself, and that trust in yourself comes from your faith in the Lord. You will be able to handle those hard moments. You will be. You will be. Your true self, your inner self will present itself in those moments. Just two more from Jim, and then I'll move on to the scripture. Showing respect is not slavery and must be taught. You know, that's deep. It just means that, you know, we need to respect others because you don't know what your others have gone through. Some of the meanest, cruel people in the world, they just need to be loved. They might be reacting hard on someone or be bullies, but deep down inside, they'll respond to love if they're given enough of it or given it in the right way. You don't begin to live until you've lost everything. Jim's already said that earlier, but remember this. When you're at the bottom of the barrel and you've lost everything, all you want to do is focus upwards and climb out of that barrel and learn from your mistakes and never let it happen to you again. Just say, I will never, ever let life treat me this way again. Well, I want to give you some scriptures today as we bring the show to a close in a little while. And this one, I believe, goes right in hand to here about the boxer in the ring. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 12. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. The good fight that you were called. 1 Corinthians 9, 24 through 27. Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. So I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air, but I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. Well, that one's talking to me because I'm not here just giving y'all a lot of words to act like I'm a positive guy that's going through a lot of cancer treatments and perhaps it's not going to go so well because, you know, whatever. No. I'm telling you that I draw my strength from knowing that the Lord is using me. I've given myself to the Lord and that whatever his will is, I accept. And I'm not going to worry about whether I live for 1 year, 5 years or 10 years or whatever. I'm just going to serve the Lord every day and love everyone I can and set the best examples I can so that my memory, whenever that becomes me as a memory to those that are left behind, will get strength from knowing me. Let me just read some others here that are just beautiful. James chapter 1, verse 12. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial. For when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. Eternal life. 2 Timothy 2 through 5. An athlete is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. Yeah, it's not your rules. It's the good rules from the Bible. Psalm 13, 5. But I have trusted in your steadfast love. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. I want to echo that. I trust the Lord and I look forward to eternity with him. Philippians 3, 12 through 14. Not that I've already obtained this or I am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus had made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Absolutely. Matthew 7, 21 through 23. Take heart on this one. Be careful. Listen to this one carefully, please. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name or do many mighty works in your name? And then will I declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. I rejoice in the fact that I know the Lord and that I trust him and my life is totally in his hands. Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Galatians 6:9. And let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. I love that. Matthew 10:22. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake, but the one who endures to the end will be saved. Do not give up. This is one of my lifetime favorites. Isaiah chapter 40, verses 29 through 31. I've shared before that I had a pocket knife for years in my pocket that had this verse on it. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. Here it is. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And the last one, 1 Corinthians 6, verses 19 through 20. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. Well, I just want to thank you for listening with me today, listening to me today. I'm listening also. That's a neat concept is that as I read these scriptures, I'm reading them, but I'm listening. Better believe that to be true. So what I want to end today with is a summary. I love every one of you. I'm going to be fine. I'm the man in the ring. I got a chance to just respond to all the prayers. And I got the greatest doctors in the world. I love my doctors. They're saints. And I believe in them. I trust them. I've got the most wonderful support system imaginable. How I earn my income is a beautiful way that I've got a lot of flexibility and people that appreciate me and allow me to do what I do to help them do what they do. I have an incredibly blessed life, but remember this. This is not a goodbye. It's just an acceptance of the phase that I'm in now. Remember, I'm renewing my lease, and I'm ready for more years to come. As I've laid on the tables for surgeries. When I was doing the jaw surgery, it was my 18th time to go under anesthesia. And it was the easiest I've ever gone through. It was absolutely beautiful. And when I woke up from it, when I went into the anesthesia, I told them, you know, I don't like to be nauseous. I just don't like to come out of it like that. So I walked down the hall that got onto the operating table. There are about six people in the room. They're all wonderful up at MCV Hospital. And they said, stand here. And they asked you the last question, you know, what's your name? What's your birthday? You lay down on the table. They put the oxygen mask on me. And they said, we just want to make sure you're getting some good oxygen. Take three deep breaths. And I took my three deep breaths. And then usually they say, count backwards from 10. And then you get to 8. And then you wake up and the surgery's over. So after I took three deep breaths, I said, so when are you going to put me under? They said, it'll be soon. That's all I remember. Then I woke up and I didn't have any ill feelings. I woke up in the post-recovery room and and a song was in my mind. I was thinking about my wife, Donna. It was a Beatles song, I Feel Good. And it was just, I was thinking about my wife. And then this song hit my mind. It's just funny. Back in the 60s, there was a song called Red Rubber Ball, and the lyrics go, yes, the worst is over now. The morning sun is shining like a red rubber ball. I told that to this wonderful nurse that was helping me through recovery. She's about 28 or 9 years old. I asked her if she ever heard that song before. She said no. And when I gave her the lyrics, she said, well, look, the sun's coming up. You know, it's sunny outside. Life is beautiful. I want to end it with this. As I lay on tables, when I go through anesthesia sometimes or a procedure, sometimes I recite the Lord's Prayer. And when you listen to the lyrics, when you listen to the words of this prayer and imagine that perhaps you just are going through the valley of the shadow of death and that you will fear no evil. It's real. The Lord is protecting us. And here's the Lord's Prayer as I end today's show. It's Psalm 23, verses 1 through 6. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. God bless each one of you. I'm here for you. If you need me for anything, just go to the website and give me a call. God bless you.
Thanks for listening to Right Thinking with Steve Copeland. I look forward to being with you again next week. And remember, don't quit. Plan ahead. It will get better. God bless you and have a great week.